it's gonna take some finances. So this is where it's pointed out here. What did he say there? What verse was that? Verse 16. Someone read that.
Verse 16.
Uh-huh. That's verse 16.
And all the silver and gold that thou canst find in all the province of Babylon, with the freewill offering of the people and of the priests, offering willingly for the house of their God which is in Jerusalem.
Yeah.
That thou mayest buy speedily with this money.
Yeah.
Bullocks and rams and lambs and their meat offerings and their drink offerings and their offer them upon the altar of the house of your God which is in Jerusalem.
And read verse 18.
And whatsoever shall seem good to thee and to thy brethren to do with the rest of the silver and gold that do after the will of your God.
Yeah, so
that do after the will of your God.
Yeah, that do after the will of your God. So you accumulate this money and everything because you say you're going back there so you can worship your God, but I'm going to tell you right now, you can't do it without what? Love, money. Can't have church without money. What? Yeah. Your God requires that you make all these offerings. You don't have nothing. You're a slave. So I'm going to give you some of my tax money to go buy the stuff you need to make your offerings to your God. And when people say that you don't need money to run a church, you just say, you are so blessed, but so stupid. I love you so much, but you are so stupid. You're blessed, but you're stupid. You have to have M-O-N-E-Y. We can't have church unless we what, pay tithes and give offerings. It's just, we just, without that, you say, we just love God. You do? Yeah, okay. Yeah. Just love God. We poor, we broke, joke. Get the tire on three, get the church on three rims and a donut. That's how we break it. And we have a church. So this secular person knew that you need money to do what y'all talking about. All right, so God starts giving favor within the economy for you. Starts blessing your purse. Okay, that's some of the things that it takes to have church. Okay, let's jump to verse 25, and then we'll get into our lesson maybe. Of this, Ezra, the 7:25, what happened?
And thou, Ezra, after the wisdom of thy God that is in thy hand, set magistrates and judges, which may judge all the people which are beyond the river, all such as know the laws of God, of thy God, and teach ye them, that know them not.
Amen. So Ezra, I know you're a teacher. You have the ability. It's in your heart to do it. So here's your purpose. And this is what I want you to do. Your purpose is to teach the people of Israel the law of their God. I'm giving you the authority to do it. And I'm also giving you the means to do it. That's when you know that your heart is set. Things is coming into play. Now, have they started fasting yet?
No.
Not yet. It's just that what makes all of these favors fall in line for him? His heart is right.
His heart is right.
His heart is right. His heart is right. And God is working with his heart. That's right. So, you think this is enough? Hey, man, you got all this stuff going for you. Why call fast? Why afflict yourself? Things is in motion. You see everything lining up. Your plans is taking place. The puzzle has come together. Why call a fast? Anybody ever do that? Things be going just good, and then Pastor Hill, we go fast. That's probably what we're going to pay attention to. We're going to fast 2 weeks. I'm coming to pray in the morning, in the evening, the day, in the noon, all day long. Everybody, come on, join in. It's an invitation. You said, things is happening over here for me. Why should Ben Shorty go into it? I said, she's got all the money.
Wish.
Calling, everything's great. Why should we go on a fast?
That, when you make up your mind to do that, all forces of hell come against you trying to stop you from carrying out that will.
Have we got to the promised land yet?
No.
Haven't got there yet. But We got a good head and a good heart to say that this is where, that's where we want to go. Mm-hmm. And God starts making things, lining stuff up, coming into play, but we haven't got there yet.
Mm-hmm.
What's it going to take to get there? Where you got to face to get there? What do you know you're going to run into?
Opposition.
You know what you're going to run into to get there. Let's see. That's where our lesson picks up today. So, we have opportunities and we have challenges. Malachi 3 and so forth says, bring you all the tithe into the storehouse and prove me therewith and see if I will not open to you the what?
Windows
of heaven. So somebody is bringing in tithes and offerings, and then the windows, it's been described, open up the windows of heaven, is that's called the opportunities of life. I'll open to you the opportunities and I will pour you out a blessing. Mm-hmm. So now that I got opportunities, I'm bringing in my tithes and offerings, as the word says. Mm-hmm. I got my opportunities, but I'm also going to have my what, challenges. Because yeah. They just ain't going our way. I mean, they just going to be there. That's just the way it is. Challenges. So, all right. So now, this is why Ezra called a fast, because he knew the people were going to come, some of them were going to jump on board. But there's some things outside of our hands. It's going to be, we just don't have the muscle, the wherewithal to take care of the stuff that's out there that we're going to face. You're going to face a challenge. You're going to face a challenge Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. That your resources, your hands, your might, your ability can't handle. And that's the problem with a lot of us is that we worship on Sunday and have all of the splendor and worship and everything going on, but there's some stuff going on from this renewed mind that you're going to be facing with opportunities, going to be there, challenges also. Challenges is that, the thing about the challenges is that you can't beat them. You're going to need some extra help. They're going to be there. I guarantee you. I guarantee you. They're going to be there. Okay. So, what kind of should you just name it? So, let's see. Let's read Ezra 8:21. My lesson. Man, it is so hot down here. I'm going to jump in my swimsuit.
Then I proclaimed a fast there at the river of Ahava, that we might afflict ourselves before our God to seek of him a right way for us and for our little ones and for all of our suffering.
How can we go forth? We got to find the right way to go forth. That's what we're looking for. All right, now, the king says you can go. Now, the king, let's go ahead and read verse 22, and then we'll tell you what's happening there. We'll see what's going on there. So, let me read verse 22.
For I was ashamed to require of the king a band of soldiers and horsemen to help us against the enemy in the way. Because we had spoken unto the king, saying, the Lord of our God is upon all of them for good that seek him, but his power and his wrath is against all them that forsake him.
All right, here we go. Here we go. I am unemployed. Just got laid off. Anybody got laid off? Off the payroll. It's some real life experience. Off the payroll. Out of here. No job. No income.
Yep.
On that job, you've been witnessing. God is great. God is good. God take care of you. God can take care of me. Yada, 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 yada. What's the first thing you're going to do? What's the first thing most folks say do when you get laid out or fired, dismissed from a jail? What is it? I'll sit down with that.
Run to your dead.
What's the first thing? Yeah, you better go do this.
Uh-huh.
You better go do that. What is one of the first things that they tell you you better go do?
Unemployment.
Unemployment. Go files. Back in my day, I think the most you could get, I can only say $360. It might have been $364 exactly. And that was way a lot lower than what I had ever made. Got got kids, you got family, you got mouths you're looking at, and it comes food to feed them. Lights on, utilities on, this and all that. Is that good? Piece of advice? Should we take it up? Jump on that one? Welfare, go to the state, get some welfare. Ooh. I knew I shouldn't get the tip. I knew it was raining for some reason.
Depending on your situation, you might need to do that.
In some situation, you said you might need to.
You might need to do that for a little bit.
What you said,
you need to humble yourself.
Uh-oh. I like Brother Clever. Majority of people are going to take up that advice. Now here's, let's look at this real life situation. Here's Ezra, he done talked to the king. The king says, I'm going to give you whatever you need, yada, 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 all the way down the line. Here's a portion of my taxes that I'm receiving, take that and do your thing with, yada, yada, yada. But you're vulnerable. King says, in my area, my realm, my authority, I'm telling my people not to bother you. But between here and there, guess what? And the king says, I don't even go that way. I don't even go down there that way. So, I mean, now we do have, you know, taxations and all that, but when I send my boys out to collect, they protect it. And they get what they need, they come on back. Now, you going passing through there to get to your promised land so you can have church. Don't you think I ought to send a couple of my boys with you? Armed? Just because I like. But Ezra came to the king and says, my God is with those people that love and honor him. He protects them. He provides for them. And that's what persuaded the king to buy into Ezra's plan to go into Jerusalem. Now, would you be shamed? You been told your boss at work? My God, Travis talking to them Jehovah's Witnesses out there. Send them on down the road, you know, to the next house. Ain't taking their material, talking big talk, you know. They come back the next time, they want to see, wait a minute, for what? For closure. Ain't that the house we tried to get into here? What's going to be Travis's attitude when if the yoga hits the fan in his life? Because that's what the devil is going to do. He's going to put you on stage in front of the rest of the world and say, now let me see what you're going to say to me. I think there's a psalm that says that when we were brought into captivity in Israel, they required of us a song. Mm-hmm. And then he says, now let me see you sing the Lord's song. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I wish I had that song. I know it's in there. Mm-hmm. Now let me see you sing the Lord's song. Ah, I got you in sickness and stress and all this and all that. Now let me see you talk to me about God. So Ezra says, I was ashamed to ask the king for protection. How many of us want to be like that? I was ashamed to ask for that kind of help. I could do it in this one. But maybe I can do it here in a little bit. I find that scripture in Psalms. What should we do? What should he do? Ask for the help? Horsemen? To help us against the enemy in the way? So, I don't want that help, so I better ask. Fasting is asking for divine intervening here on the earth, on your behalf, that you won't get in any other kind of way. Woo! Anybody heard of anybody getting sick going on fast? Anybody running out of money going on fast? Anybody in all type of life issues to say that I'm going to go on a fast. Now, a leader will ask, say, group of people to go on a fast. But that answer to that prayer has to benefit everybody that's going in on the affliction. It should. If a leader is sick and everybody want to join in on that fast, and they said, we're joining in because he's valuable to us. We need his leadership. We need him continuing sowing into our lives spiritual food. We got our sister or brother or whoever. But everybody's got to do what? Benefit from that fast, from that affliction. How many ever heard of the radio station WFIM?
What's in it for me?
What's in it for me?
Psalms 137.
What is it, Candy?
Psalms 137 is the
song. Psalms 137. If you can keep your finger on two different places at one time. Psalms 137.
By the river?
Wait, let's get there. By the rivers of Babylon. That's where they're leaving out of. Leaving out of Babylon. He says, we're there by the rivers. Go ahead.
There we sat down, yea, we wept, for we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song. That they
and they that wasted us required of us myrrh, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. And then he says, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? For I forget thee, O Jerusalem. For if I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning. If I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy. If I don't have Jerusalem as my number one joy, let my mouth not be able to open up again. That's what he says. And verse 8, O daughter of Babylon, who art to be destroyed? Happy shall he be that rewarded thee as thou hast served us. But what I was referring to is that verse 1 to verse 3, they brought us into captivity. The devil brings you into, or to bring you into captivity, make you sick, make you broke, get your job, all these kind of things. And then he'll say, now let me see you, praise God. Not even seeing what God songs. And most people will shut up, won't say anything. But here he says that if I don't open my mouth and talk about the joy of the presence of God, then he says I want God to close my mouth, or I won't ever say anything. So it's a definite determination. That's what Ezra has, definite determination to get back into worship. That's his definite determination. And so he's saying now our number one strategy is going to be the thieves along the roadside. Mm-hmm. And the king says, you better let me send a couple of my boys with you. Mm-hmm. And Ezra says, I'm too ashamed because I've been talking about my God, what he'll do and can do. I'm too ashamed to. He was too ashamed in himself to go for that request, so he just declined. Now, so he's got to trust in God for his survival along the way. This is a test of faith. When that job goes south, when that income goes south, and all this and all that, what do most people do? Is it a test of faith when the opportunity and the challenge show up at the same time? Oh, Lord. Why not just opportunity? Why the challenge? Why not? See, this is what we are really today. You know, we talk about prosperity. I've seen talk about it for what, 2-3 weeks now. Opportunity. Yeah, I guarantee you, opportunity gonna hit you square in the head tomorrow. Bam. Challenge is going to be there also. Opportunities and challenge at the same time. And most of us will take the easy way out, which are going to be the state aid and so forth and what have you. That's just the way that most folks are going to do. They don't register for the aid, but they don't realize that it's an opportunity also.
But that opportunity, to me, is taking advantage of the treasure that you stored up, paying into
I've seen, I've heard I was waiting for that.
You use that opportunity to take advantage of that.
Some people say it's insurance.
Yeah, you know, to take advantage of that. Why are you, operating faith,
To go to that, overcome that challenge.
Yeah,
I've seen that too. I mean, I took the 364. I didn't even feel like I got it. I don't know what bill is paid. I really don't know.
Then they took tax out of that.
But don't get tax out of that. Matter of fact, I didn't even exhaust it.
I never ran.
I let it go. I said, I got to do something. This ain't done. It wasn't even worth going to the bank to cash a check.
Exactly.
I wasted more time and money going to cash this check. Wasn't worth it. That was my look on it.
Man, you try to plan for peace.
And of course, I prayed and probably went to some fastings and things like that. But that, back in the day, this is what I'm saying, that we have opportunity and it doesn't come without a challenge. And most folks will just take the opportunity and not try to overcome the challenge. I mean, they'll take the soft bailout. A soft cushion. We call it safety net. Yes. What do you do? This guy here, he would say, I'm too ashamed to rely on the state of the king. I'm going to do something else. So, verse 23, we did what?
Fasted and besought our God for this.
For what? What are they looking for God for? What's the definite purpose that they're looking for God for?
Direction. Right way. The right way to
protection. Enemy out there. Enemy is out there. We're in your hands. We're going to do your will, God. You got to let us live. And we're going to show you that you got to let us live because we're going to stop eating. How about that, John? You got to show you got to show God you show up because we are afflicting ourselves through eating. Now, imagine this. Today, say we're going to go from here to L.A. We're going to travel from here to L.A. What's the likely way we're going to do that? Mode of transportation.
Why?
Fly, top dog, drive, second choice. Bus, maybe third choice. Train, maybe fourth choice. Pretty easy transportational modes, right? Mm-hmm. This bunch right here, how you going to get there?
Walking.
And not so much favorable roads, and along the roadside is the bandit. From here to there. So they was in definitely fear of their lives. And when your life is in fear, the report is a bad report. Do you turn it over with fasting and prayer and say, God, if I live, it's going to be because you keep me alive to get me to where I want to go, the land of health. We're talking about fasting, we're talking about afflicting our souls now. We ain't talking about trying to get the school board figure and all this and all that. We're talking about some serious God you got to show up is on you. We travel that road and the bandits are there, protection is you the guy, you the hosting with the arms to fight against the enemy. We don't even have any weapons to fight against. It's all on you. That's when you leave it out there for God. When you do that. That's what.
And that enemy was a serious threat. Because all the people in that land realized that when the people of God is worshiping like they're supposed to do, we have no power against them. And that was their goal, was to stop them from rebuilding that temple.
Yeah, and verse 31 says, now let's go for some misuse of fasting while we're talking about it. Matthew 6:16. Misuse of fasting. Woo, is it 10:25 for real? Man, I can't believe I stayed down in this hot box that long.
I can't believe I stayed with you. In a suit.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about, brother.
I'm soaking up down here.
16. Okay, moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But when thou fastest, anoint thy head, and you will wash thy face. So we don't want to get into any that thou appear not unto man to fast, but unto thy Father which is in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee how?
Openly.
Proper way to fast. So now I'm going to read verse 31. We're going to get out of here. I had some more verses, but this is too hot. Then we departed from the river Ahava on the 12th day of the first month. That's some years later after the decree went out to go into Jerusalem. And the hand of our God was what? Upon us. He delivered us from the hand of who? The enemy. That's what it was. God protect us. And on such and of such as lay in wait. By the way, the enemy was there. He was there. He was there. We know he was there. He was there. God protect us. Now, the right path, the right way to go, moving forward, came after they had already went on that difficult journey. This is the challenge for a lot of people today. The challenge is that they don't want to go on that difficult journey. When I went into business, I knew what the end result was, a fat bankrupt. I knew that, brother. My own boss, calling my own shots, get up when I want to, all that's down there. But along the way, a challenge. Most folks don't want that, Brother John. They don't want that.
Well, that's okay. I can get it.
You might not eat three meals today. You might eat one and a half. You got to put money into the business to get further down in the business. All this, all that, all these things that come up. You may not be able to afford medical insurance as you go on your journey. All this and all that. But most folks just see you when you get to the journey. They don't see you on the journey. Most folks see you when they complete the journey. They don't see you when you're going through the journey. Yeah, some challenges. Opportunity. Opportunity. Challenge. We got to get out of here, y'all.